Welcome to another news. I'm Jeff Brady. Today we talk about the physiological effects of RF radiation in smart meters with Josh Del Sol, producer and director of the documentary film Take Back Your Power. But first, we listen to part of an interview with Stacy Lin. Stacy Lin was a guest early last year discussing how she alerted her community about ICLEI, the International Council of Local Environmental Initiatives, and she revealed how large amounts of taxpayer money is being spent annually. She saved 300 local jobs, scores of private businesses by bringing awareness to ICLEI policies that were to be mainly voted on in secret. By exposing the money trail, plus being successful in saving jobs in private businesses, she was retaliated against. Those people who retaliated were then exposed for their Agenda 21 business connections. Stacy's son, as you may recall, was also taken from her in what has been described as a complete miscarriage of justice. We go now to hear a clip from that interview. Well, we've done a few shows on UN Agenda 21, ICLEI, and the various implementations such as smart meters. But can you remind listeners what Agenda 21 is and how you exposed it manifesting in the Fort Collins area of Larimer County, Colorado?
Yes, Agenda 21 is a program of the United Nations. It is focusing on the environment. A lot of the things they do is attempting to make the world a more sustainable place. And a lot of times you hear the word sustainability, and of course everybody wants clean water and clean air. If you have children, of course, you're worried about the future. So it's all placed under the basic guise of saving the planet. Carbon dioxide is the main focus, of course, and the interesting thing about carbon dioxide is if you look at the United States Department of Carbon Dioxide Information Analysis Center, they will actually tell you how much carbon dioxide is in Earth's atmosphere. And so as an investigative journalist, I wanted to know exactly why we were so focused on CO2 and why we were so interested in reducing those levels. The department actually says that the total amount of CO2 in Earth's atmosphere is 0.0001%. So I started to wonder, why are we so interested in reducing that if it's such a small amount to begin with? And science also says that those levels are naturally decreasing. So what I came up with was I stumbled upon an organization called the International Council of Local Environmental Initiatives, and I ran into that through the City of Fort Collins website. I became interested in all of this because the City of Fort Collins began a large attack on small businesses that had been in Fort Collins for almost 100 years combined. And the questions I was asking the city and the answers I was getting didn't make sense, so I just started to delve into the motivation behind it. So the city was trying to eliminate privately owned trash companies, and they said that the city wanted to have all the same color trash containers. That was a little bit strange to me. I thought there must be something more behind it than that. Mm-hmm. So I did discover that the city of Fort Collins has been a member of ICLEI for almost 20 years. No official knew about the organization. Nobody in the city knew that we were a member of this international organization. And the interesting thing is, the way that it's implemented is through a sustainability plan or a long-term planning process. And about 5 years ago, I realized that New York City also has the exact same sustainability plan as Fort Collins was implementing. So I have done a lot of research around the United States trying to figure out the common threads and what the ultimate goals are with Agenda 21 and Local Agenda 21, which is known as ICLEI. As I was investigating this, I started speaking publicly, I started writing, and I did focus on the local governments in the state of Colorado. I began getting phone calls from all around the United States asking if I could help them as well. So I have a lot of knowledge about Agenda 21 and ICLEI throughout the U.S. and figured out ways to successfully defeat these policies that were hurting small businesses.
When was this, when this awareness kicked in on for you?
Well, I started wondering about what the city was doing to local businesses in 2008. It didn't take me long to figure out what was actually behind the plans and who was forcing these policies on small businesses. So 2008 is when I began the investigation. 2009, the city of Fort Collins had a major fight on its hands because I didn't think it was proper for the city to put these longtime business owners out. We were successful in protecting these small businesses. They're still in business today, nearly 4 years later. And I took that, the process that I learned from the Fort Collins trash fight, and started helping people around the state protect their small trash companies as well. ICLEI goes after trash companies as one of their first policies to implement locally, because there's a lot of money involved, and because they can make people feel guilty for having trash.
Oh, yes, I think some of that is happening here as well in New York City, and we'll get to that. And before we get into your personal story, if you could tell listeners some of the ways that you brought awareness to your community through writing articles, a newsletter, and some of the strategy maybe that could help other activists maybe here in New York City or other areas.
Yeah, that's a great question. The first thing I did was I began attending city council meetings. I had never been involved politically prior to the trash issue in Fort Collins, but I went to every single council meeting. I listened, I took notes, and I started asking questions. And the biggest thing people can do is ask questions about where the money is coming from, who stands to benefit from it. Even, sadly, private companies who are ICLEI members can figure out how to get into the city and get special benefits and perks. So I started going to council meetings. I also started a small newspaper that I hand-delivered to the small business owners in Fort Collins. A lot of times small business owners don't have time to stay current on what the city government is doing, and a lot of times they vote and implement policies before the public even knows about it. So I became very vocal, wrote articles for the newspaper, the main newspaper in Fort Collins, and I was just relentless in helping people learn what these policies actually meant to them and how it would hurt them financially.
Now, you hand-delivered this paper. Why did you do that?
Well, it was a great way for me to get to know the business owners. I love small, locally owned business owners, and I support them as much as possible. So I got to meet a lot of really hardworking people who didn't know what was coming at them, and I wanted to give them a head start so that they could fight it before the votes were done.
I see. The important part here, what I see as strategically of what you're bringing awareness to, is the money trail. Was that a driver for bringing awareness?
Initially, it was not my main motivation, because I was more disturbed by what they were doing to the people, by how they were going to destroy nearly 300 local jobs. And I saw those people's faces every time I did my research and stood up and spoke. Those people were not going to have jobs if we did not stop this takeover. So it was the people that made me passionate initially, and then I started looking at the money. I actually took the budget from the city of Fort Collins. It's 300 pages long, and I dissected it. And I needed to know how much money was being spent on Agenda 21 and ICLEI programs versus fire, police, and roads. And that's when I became disturbed even more than what was happening to the people, because I found out that we were spending nearly $1 million to teach people how to feel when they were outside. And I know that's difficult to believe, but it's in our budget.
What does that mean exactly?
So they wanted to spend all of this money on programs that would teach children and even senior citizens how they were supposed to feel when they were walking down a trail in the woods. And I know New York City has a similar part of their budget that does similar things. So if you go to your budget, you will see a similar program to teach people how to feel outside when they're outdoors.
But in Fort Collins, it's near $1 million for this?
It's $835,000. That was our budget 2 years ago.
Is that an annual?
It is. It is. One of the reasons that I was looking at the money aspect was because a lot of times these sustainability policies actually hurt minority populations and disadvantaged populations. So then I wanted to see what is the city actually doing to hurt these populations. And here's one example. And remember, New York City has the exact same sustainability plan that Fort Collins has, so this applies. We were spending $1 million, nearly $1 million, on a bicycle program where the city would buy bicycles. Now, remember, that takes away from small bike shop owners. City buys bicycles, and then you can use a bicycle for free when you're in Fort Collins. But to use that bicycle, you have to have a credit card. So the people who would benefit the most from using a bicycle for free don't have access to it. You have to leave your credit card with the city so that that's the guarantee that you'll bring the bike back. But I don't know very many people on who are struggling financially who actually have credit cards that are valid. So they can't even access this city program that they're actually paying for.
There was a lot of criticism with that plan here when it was suggested or proposed. I know you mentioned some of the successes that you had in stopping ICLEI-driven regulations in your area, but can you go down some of the lists of the prominent successes that you've had in maybe bringing awareness to temporarily prevent or completely stop some of the implementations?
Yes, the most fabulous success we had in Fort Collins was that we did save those private businesses. We still have 300 jobs that would not exist if the city would have successfully ended their businesses. I took that process and helped other communities in Colorado save the very same small business owners. So in Jefferson County, we saved 13 small businesses. I mean, that is an unbelievable success. And then I was writing papers to help other communities around the United States understand the process for how you expose ICLEI in Agenda 21, how you help elected officials learn about it, because honestly, most elected officials do not have the knowledge about the policies that they're voting on. Some of the officials do know, but it's a very secret topic. You just don't hear a lot of discussion about ICLEI or Agenda 21 in local governments. So you help your officials learn about it. You show them the money that is required to implement these policies. The city of Fort Collins actually had to increase our sales tax rate just to cover ICLEI and Agenda 21 programs. And another good example of that, so that you can start looking at your budgets, is we were spending $835,000 to teach people about the difference between a CFL light bulb and a incandescent light bulb. But the thing that the city was leaving out in their education program was the mercury toxicity in the CFL light bulbs. They did not explain to people or educate them about how to handle a CFL if it broke, what to do with children and women who are pregnant. There was no education in the risks. And that led me back to my concern for the people and my passion for helping people understand what these programs were actually doing to their life and the planet.
That was part of an interview with investigative journalist Stacy Lynn, who exposed massive corruption relating to UN Agenda 21 in ICLEI in Fort Collins, Colorado. Utility companies worldwide are replacing electricity, gas, and water meters with new generation smart meters. The so-called smart meter is also a powerful transmitter and receiver, using wireless microwave technology similar to cell phones to communicate back to the utility company. This information alone raises a long list of concerns that's at the core of resistance amid aware communities, local governments, and utility companies. Some of the concerns include overbilling, the electric grid, vulnerable to hacking, surveillance and tracking, autism, inflammation in the body, and degradation of red blood cells. If you're a regular listener to this show, you'll recall we've talked about the physiological hazards of RF radiation and inappropriate use of wireless microwave technology with many guests in the past. We're joined today by Josh Del Sol, director and producer of the documentary film Take Back Your Power, to talk about the public fight back and the research conducted for the film. Josh Del Sol, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Jeff. It's great to be here.
The Take Back Your Power documentary film that you directed and produced encapsulates almost all of the issues in the past few years that were really, I think, scattered throughout media. There were pockets of activists resisting in different parts of the country and the world, but your film really pulled it together, which is very critical. What sparked you to produce this film, and what did you find out that maybe you didn't know before you started?
Well, with the whole issue of the so-called smart meters that are being rolled out by utilities pretty much everywhere in all Western countries at this time, what sparked me initially to get on the path of making the film Take Back Your Power, it was in the summer of 2011, I started to hear about many people in California who were getting smart meters installed were having health effects. And this wasn't just a few people, it was thousands of people officially, you know, reporting to their utilities that the radio frequency radiation from the meters is causing them functional impairments, ranging from lack of sleep to ringing in the ears to nausea or rashes or various types of symptoms. I was living at the time in Vancouver, British Columbia, and when I heard that same story from a good friend of mine who was sending me some messages, and she says she was telling me how she was having the same symptoms from the same hour that the meter was installed, and she didn't know that it was installed until later that day after her symptoms started. At that point, I started to, you know, kind of get this sense of indignation or anger or you know, really a deep question. How come this issue is not being talked about with any level of transparency? And what is the story that's going on in actual fact? I mean, is it possible that all these people are just creating their own situation in their minds? It's some sort of a mass, you know, hysteria, like the utilities are trying to picture it as? Or is it possible that the meters and the microwave radiation from them are actually causing health problems in a percentage of people? So later on, I learned about the constitutional issues and how they're planning to share the data of what goes on in your home and collect that data to start with, and the hacking issues, home fires, and rising costs, and, you know, significantly rising utility bills that are all associated with the smart meter and smart grid program, as I understand it, is being scheduled to be deployed in the Northeast areas who have not yet already have it installed.
Right. It's beginning to roll out this way. Some people out in Long Island are definitely paying attention. We'll talk about that in a bit. But so the physiological, the health effects was the initial spark that brought your interest into this issue. In your film, you showed some very interesting scientific experimentation regarding what blood cells do when you're standing next to a smart meter. And that was a very interesting experiment. Can you tell listeners about that?
Yeah, we worked with a chiropractic physician who has experience in different modalities, including live blood cell analysis. And so he worked with a technician that specializes in doing this for a living to actually get some footage of before and after. You know, what does the live blood cell look like before exposure to the so-called smart meter compared to immediately following, after 2 minutes of exposure, standing 1 foot away from the meter? And they did use a control group. It wasn't an officially published study with hundreds and hundreds of subjects taking part, but what it did show was that with the analog meter, there was no before and after change. But with the pulsing smart meter, somebody standing 1 foot away from it, the change from before and after, just 2 minutes separating chronologically, the change was massive. And there was various three different types of degradation happening to the blood cells from those tests. And so we show that actual footage in the film. And from what the feedback that I'm getting, because, you know, human beings are visual creatures, right? The reason why we're not onto this thing about how we're all being affected by microwave radiation is because we can't see it. But when people see that the blood cells themselves change and their only environmental variable is the smart meter, that has a pretty profound effect. So we do interview, I believe, 6 doctors, PhDs, in Take Back Your Power, and variety of whistleblowers and government agents and the former premier of British Columbia's and their lawyers and lay people, all of whom have combined to give the viewer a tremendous insight about this issue that is purposely being suppressed, and disinformation, I've come to realize, is purposely being disseminated because of the vested interests involved with both the utility industry and, of course, the wireless, all industry that is using wireless technologies.
Other health effects that you've pointed out were autism in children that could be associated with wireless, and inflammatory markers going up in the body, so inflammation in the body. But the degradation changes in the blood, to me, was very powerful, because it seemed to me that if you're standing 1 foot away from a smart meter for 2 minutes, and one of the changes were bottle capping, which is the edges of the blood cell look serrated, like a bottle cap. But the other change, which occurred to a woman who almost fainted, she said, they were clustered together. They were grouping together like glue.
Mm-hmm.
And the red blood cells were slowing down.
Yeah. I mean, Robert Becker has written a book that's kind of a landmark book on this understanding that we all eventually will have to come to accept, is that human beings are not just chemical beings. We're not just, just the atoms, just the physical. We are electromagnetic beings as well. And so, the heart is, it pumps because there's an electrical charge that fires. The brain, the neurons, same thing, where electricity runs through our body in a very regulated way that is harmonized with our optimal functioning by default. So when we introduce pulsed radiation, and even the smart meters have something called a switching mode power supply, which your analog meter does not, but the smart meters have this device that chops up the electricity signal so that it produces something called dirty electricity. And this is all covered in the film. We explain it, and if you're feeling like a bit overwhelmed with understanding this, there's two issues, that the health issues that the smart meter makes, they're both covered in the film. But the crux of it is that our bodies aren't designed to have this kind of radiation coursing through it on a regular basis, even if it's low level. And there's actually thousands of studies that have been peer-reviewed, published scientific studies have been put out since the 1930s, that the majority of them indicate there's some biological effect happening, whether it's to the human being or whether it's in vitro or whether it's to other organisms and the environment. We're all being affected by this. And so what's happened is that the governing bodies, the FCC, which has somehow, the Communications Commission, has been tasked with providing the so-called safety limit in this country. And why the Environmental Protection Agency is involved is, that's beyond me and many, many other people. But their standards are based on only on input from engineers who want to facilitate the proliferation of wireless despite all the harm being done. And their standards do not take into account all of these thousands of studies that produce effects. So it's almost bewildering to when we understand how skewed the science has been on this, that they have FCC guidelines and the so-called scientists involved predetermine that the only mechanism that can cause harm is heating from microwaves. So they require, in order to consider the harm being done, they require the tissues and the cells to actually heat up by a certain number of degrees in a limited amount of time in order for a technology or a frequency to be deemed unsafe. this is unthinkable and completely beyond irresponsible to the hundreds of independent scientists and the millions of people around the planet now who are looking at the elephant in the room of how dangerous these technologies are actually becoming. And because we don't see the frequencies, and because the rate of change that they are making in our bodies is slow, it's incremental, especially in the case of loss of fertility, which is documented in the science. Because of this, we don't actually have an interaction with the mechanism of harm, but the science is very clear on it, and the industry, because it stands to benefit to the tune of hundreds of billions, if not trillions of dollars, is doing its best to proliferate a cover-up of the highest magnitude.
It is a cover-up, and they're really exploiting the natural ability for people wanting to communicate with each other, especially in the cell phone world. Yep. We've had a number of guests on, for example, Dr. Carmen Bolter and Dr. Perlin Jerry, who have been affected by smart meters, by the pulsing of these meters. And you go into detail about the pulsing, and you show these insects, aphids, I believe, on a leaf. But that was from a airport radar about 14 miles away. Mm-hmm. And you were explaining in the film how radar pulses can affect very subtle realms within our environment. Mm-hmm. Does that connect to the smart meters at all?
Well, the same frequencies, microwave frequencies, are pulsing from smart meters. And the utilities will say, oh, they're only on for 45 or 60 seconds a day, and they're safe. Their magnitude's lower than a cell phone emits. What we've found, and when somebody simply just measures, is that they're pulsing every few seconds. So even though each pulse, according to a court-ordered document in California that PG&E was required to submit, according to their documentation, each pulse is on average for 4 milliseconds, and it's every few seconds. And it's 24/7. It never stops. You know, you're exposed to it whether you want to or not. You can't shut it off at night. The utilities aren't looking at the fact that it's always pulsing every few seconds. They're just combining the total duration of those 4 millisecond pulses into 45 or 60 second total per day. And the other thing that has become clearly obvious is that the emissions from the meters, the microwave pulses, are between hundreds and thousands of times higher, more radiation coming from those devices than an active cell phone currently, on a call. So if you were to take a cell phone that's on a call and a smart meter and put them next to each other and measure the microwave radiation from 1 foot away of both of those devices, the smart meter would, according to our tests and independent tests, be between 500 and 8,000 times more radiation than a cell phone.
Well, that explains it, what has been happening from people that I know as well who have complained about this. And I think some people are more sensitive to this than others. Mm-hmm. What the doctor said in your documentary, Take Back Your Power, was some people may not show symptoms externally, but everyone's going through some type of degradation in the blood.
Yeah, we have two doctors who both come to that conclusion independently in the film. Both of their lab work indicated the same thing. Inflammation seems to be across the board, whether people feel it or not, according to Dr. Dietrich Klinghardt, who is a German-American, world-renowned physician and really a pioneer in bridging East and West medicine. Again, utilities are really not wanting to look at this. But at this point, I would just like to be really clear that especially if you do not have one of these so-called smart meters on your house, whether it's for your electricity or your gas or your water, you do have the right to not consent. You do have the right to not have one of these meters on your house. You need to specify that in writing to your utility very clearly that you do not consent. And also something that we've been working with, actually a very accomplished lawyer in New York State, who has put together a template that anyone can use to not only specify your non-consent, but also make the individuals responsible, personally liable as individuals.
You mentioned in the film the $11 billion stimulus bill here in the U.S. that President Obama signed to create a, quote, smart grid that would reduce electricity use by 4%. This is an important area here, but could you elaborate on the context of that energy stimulus bill?
Sure. So if you go back to 2008 and early 2009, when the stimulus money was allocated, there was originally $3.4 billion allocated for utilities to install smart meters, essentially. That was later increased, according to Time magazine, to $11 billion. And we're hearing reports from some smart grid insiders and executives that it could be as high as $28 billion of taxpayer money has, you know, been funneled for these deployments. So what that means in real terms per utility is that a utility such as PECO in Philadelphia got allocated $200 million to deploy 600,000 smart meters by the end of 2014, I believe, was the date, if I'm not mistaken. So utilities, the maximum grant the utility is getting is $200 million to go along with this and not ask questions and to push it through whether people want it or not. So what we're realizing is that by writing polite letters and requests and kind of asking if we can please opt out, that hasn't got very far in most areas. Vermont, I believe, does have a free opt-out, which any of your listeners, everyone in Vermont, definitely notify them of that if they don't already know. But utilities are really not wanting to grant people their rights. So what we're realizing is that we're having to demand those rights and to do so with an effective documentation. We have something available that is just being released around this time, and by the time this interview airs, it should be up on our website, takebackyourpower.net. And if you click on the solutions button on takebackyourpower.net, you'll be able to have free access to a solution that works for you not to have one of these devices.
Josh, regarding the $11 billion stimulus bill, what are the stated objectives?
Well, according to industry and the information that we're being sold is that smart meters are a necessary upgrade that utilities are making. They're to modernize the electricity grid. So all these, you know, vague sort of buzzwords. But when it comes down to it, they're doing their best to convince people that they're going to save energy, that the costs are going to be reduced, that we're going to help the environment and give people more control over the energy use in their home, and to make the grid more secure and electricity outages more quickly restored.
Mm-hmm.
And in each one of those cases, the independent research and just looking at the facts and the truth about the situation is it's actually the opposite. I mean, the amount of doublespeak in this issue that we've uncovered is beyond ridiculous. According to the pilot studies of all smart grids, all known pilot studies, the amount of energy saved is nil, and in fact, in some cases, smart grids with functioning smart meters actually use more energy. And a report issued by the coal industry last August referred to that with wireless technology and infrastructure such as this, to transport 1 gigabyte of data, you need to burn 1 pound of coal. This is within an industry study. So we're looking at all of these proliferation of wireless, not only the meters, but their version is having all of your appliances also pulsing transmitting microwave transmissions on a regular basis so they can communicate back to the meter about what you're doing in your home and how you're using those appliances. So all of this combines to, of course, a situation where there's not less energy being used, there's more. The other thing that people are noticing when they get the smart meters installed is their bills go up. Anywhere from 10 to, in some cases, 1,000% in some extreme cases, but on average, 10 to 30%, just paying more for electricity usage. And there's no recourse that people seem to have. And eventually, utilities are planning to, and many have already started to charge time of use So you're going to be paying double or triple for your electricity during peak times of use if you allow, you know, to have one of these meters on your home. Beyond that, even just to touch on the other points of making the grid more secure and making your home more secure, it's been demonstrated that the meters are highly hackable, that students can easily hack into not only your home but your appliances and shut them off and do whatever functions are available remotely. And the former CIA director, as seen in our film, has actually stated on the record, at least as far as being on in the film goes, that the smart meters can be hacked by a student with a cell phone in China, and that what they're calling a smart grid is a very dumb grid, a stupid grid, in fact, is the term he used in our film. So this is, it's kind of the cat's coming out of the bag and for this issue, when we realize that it's not saving energy, it's making everything more vulnerable, it's harming people and the environment, it's your bills are intended to skyrocket purposefully by the utilities, and it's not producing any net benefit to the people whatsoever.
The overbilling or the overcharging in relation to a newly installed smart meter or a smart meter as compared to an analog meter, you had pointed out that the pulsing takes a lot of power. Do you know where the overbilling is coming from? Is that an actual correlation from kilowatt hours?
It's difficult to say exactly with accuracy at this point, but I after researching this issue in depth, I do have some ideas there. As a bit of background, there is a systemic issue with bills being increased unjustifiably, and it's happening around the world. In Australia, there's a clip from the film in which a news reporter reports on a story where an engineer found out that his smart electric meter was overbilling, and he brought this information and all of his data, how it's overbilling and why he thought it was overbilling. He brought that to his utility, and instead of listening to that and responding, they offered to pay him off. And the result from that was there was a call for a national investigation, which didn't officially happen, of course, because of utility interference, it's my understanding. But my belief of why the meters are registering more energy than you're actually using is two reasons. Number one, it's because of the pulsed microwave transmissions, and because that's using energy to facilitate the home area network, is what utilities are calling it, the HAN. And number two, as mentioned earlier, each one of these meters has something called a switching mode power supply. And that what that does is converts the AC electricity of the grid to a DC current for the meter itself because it's a digital device, for it to function and to transmit wirelessly. What that does, it chops up the smooth 60 hertz AC current approximately 40,000 times per second. So imagine a smooth sine wave being chopped up 40,000 times per second into a series of square waves, which actually produce an infinite range of high frequencies, which then piggyback on the wiring in your home. So all of the wiring and the electricity in your home is not only having the 60 hertz cycle, but all of these high voltage transients, which is creating a field that goes throughout your home. And that's not only causing harm, but it's also creating a wasting of electricity situation that's eventually ending up in a higher ground voltage. And the many electricians are finding out about this, and they know what's going on, and some of them are talking and others aren't. But, you know, if you have knowledge about this as an engineer or as an electrician, you're listening to this, please, please do look into this issue of wasted electricity and the dirty electricity creating an increased ground voltage situation, because it's combining greatly, I feel, to the increased cost and the human and environmental health issue.
Josh, thanks for explaining that in detail. I really appreciate that. And again, we're speaking with Josh Del Sol, producer and director of the powerful documentary film, Take Back Your Power, subtitled Investigating the Smart Grid, and smart is in quotations. One thing we didn't really emphasize here is this is worldwide. It's not just in Canada or the United States. And mm-hmm. can you elaborate on that?
Yeah. It seems to be that there's a standardization process that has happened and it is happening beyond boundaries, of beyond government boundaries and so forth. So let's face it, corporations have taken over our government. Lobbyists and corporate interests are running things now in this country, especially, and in many other most other Western countries. As an example, we have the former head of the Cellular Telecom Lobbying Association as the head of the FCC. So this is, you know, obviously to anybody who looks at this, this is a conflict of interest to have industry lobbyists running the FCC and involved in the FDA, as other Monsanto executives and so forth are. So this has prompted, at the local level, widespread resistance. And this is the key, because in the Northeast, especially in areas where you do not have smart meters, now is the time to preemptively spread the word, get involved with your community and those around you, and also your local governments and your utility, and make sure that they know that they are liable as individuals and that you do not consent, and you know, you and many people around you are going to hold them accountable to the tune of many, many millions of dollars, which we have the ability to do through this documentation. So as an example of the waking up around this issue, I believe it's 57 local governments in California have either issued moratoriums or otherwise made it come out against the installation of smart meters. And 11 of those, I believe, have criminalized the installation of smart meters. One example is Sebastopol in California, a city there. They are charging $500 for every smart meter that PG&E attempts to install. And so as I understand it, there's a bit of a standoff happening right now. So that's what it's going to take, is for the people to push our local public servants to do their job, which is what they are. They're public servants, and we have to push them to do their job, because by default they don't have the political power or the will to do so. And at the same time, be willing and take action to stand up for ourselves and our own rights by not consenting and by asserting liability of the crime and the harm that's being done. In British Columbia, where I'm from, there's also a similar number. I think 59 local governments have issued moratoriums against the rollout of smart meters. This is representing millions of people. And typically the response by the utilities is to continue on with the rollout, to not recognize the will of the people or the laws at the local level. And in some cases, utilities are actually wanting to charge you a penalty, a punitive fee, for keeping your analog meter. So this is by the letter, by the law, when you look at it, by asserting your rights to not be irradiated and surveilled in your home, utilities are actually extorting you to pay them to keep those rights intact. So what we're working on right now is, obviously, you know, people that don't have smart meters, everyone needs to know about this and then say, no, we're not going to have them where we live. That's number one. And number two, at the same time, what's happening is that people are going to be empowered to have the meters removed and replaced with safe analog meters.
That's fantastic. And the other outreach that you do is the screenings of your film. Mm-hmm. Can you tell listeners about that?
Absolutely, yeah. And I'll just mention, too, that this isn't officially announced yet, but we're just about to send a press release out that our film, Take Back Your Power, has been named the IndieFest Annual Humanitarian Award winner. And it's a tremendous honor for us. There's several hundred independent films that are up for this award each year, and this year they selected Take Back Your Power. And the other independent award that we've recently won is the Aware Guide Transformational Film of the Year Award. We really have intended to do all along is to give credibility to those that are wanting to protect their rights and stop this Orwellian spy grid from happening. And we feel that the film is now a very effective tool that people can use. They can, you know, share it with your friends and family, host a screening in your community or at a theater or for your city council, and get involved online and help us spread the word. So there is a screening that's happening at a theater in Huntington, New York, mm-hmm. and that's on June the 1st, and that is at the Cinema Arts Center. And so you can go to our website, takebackyourpower.net, click on upcoming screenings, and all the information is there. And there's also a button to host a screening as well, and that's freely available.
I'll definitely be there. I can't wait for that. And you'll be there as well, Josh, speaking.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. We are. I'm going to be coming straight from the Berkshire International Film Fest, which is our first major film festival, and we're screening earlier that day. So I'm coming from Great Barrington to Long Island, and I'm going to have to hightail it there for the screening.
Well, listen, I really appreciate the work that you've done to raise awareness, and high-quality work as well, and you deserve those awards and much more. You touch on free energy, which is something that's often discussed on this show. Mm-hmm. You know, recently a friend sent some photos of a free energy device and a group of young people in the room taking photos. Mm-hmm. And it seems that I've talked with John Hutchinson about his free energy devices. It seems like these devices either get commandeered by the military or suppressed in some way or another. Where might our society be if free energy wasn't suppressed?
Well, we actually have some evidence in the film that is publicly available, but most people don't know about it. There's in the Appendix L of the U.S. patent laws, there's a section there that has to do with the government's right, or any agency within the government, or several agencies anyways, and the right to suppress any patent, any technology, if it in the interest of national security interest. In other words, if the United States as a corporation, which it is, has an interest in maintaining the energy monopoly, which it does, and keeping us on energies that don't empower us, then they can legally, according to their own laws, suppress patents. And there's more than 5,300 that have been suppressed now. Not all of them energy technologies, but all of them technologies which, you know, they feel threaten the national security. So free energy is, I feel, or over-unity devices, they do exist. And it's something that obviously has been suppressed. It obviously has its fairly long list of shills and government plants involved in projects which are never intended to be successful, which then give credibility to the idea that it doesn't exist. But I think where this is going is really taking our power back in more than one sense of the word. So everyone does have the right and will eventually have access to technology that powers your home from within your home, or if in the case of solar, on your rooftop, and then you store it in batteries in your home, and you can, if you want to, if you choose to, you can be part of a microgrid, a community grid, sharing energy, a wise grid, but not a smart grid, as Duncan Campbell talks about.
Great.
And that's where ultimately this is going, but I'm of the perception that, you know, we also have to say no to what we don't want and assert our right to have rights, essentially, assert our right to be sovereign beings, if you will. Some people don't like that word, but assert our right to choose what we want in life. And then at the same time, that opens up space, that opens up resources and authority, if you will, to create what we do want. And I think that the suppression is very evident that inventors have undergone, but I don't think that they can the corporate forces can stem that tide for very much longer. But in order to access this technology and these solutions, we have to be willing to take a stand and to stand up for ourselves, our lives, our families, and future generations.
Indeed, yes. And, well, you've definitely got the right perspective on this, Josh. It's obvious that there are many interests that do not want free energy in the hands of the people right now. And that's in this country. But what's really weird also, Josh, is it hasn't happened worldwide, not even cold fusion. Now, I understand there are people working on it, or there were people working on cold fusion, at least in Italy, but you just don't hear about it. And you don't hear about the over-unity devices that are successful and being replicated and people using them and getting off the grid in different parts of the world.
Right. We shared a YouTube video on our Facebook page a couple of months ago with an inventor who developed an engine that runs on water or like any kind of soda or any beverage. And it doesn't even have to be clean. And he invited several executives from Detroit motor companies. I think it was GM, perhaps, but I could be mistaken. But I know there were executives with big auto manufacturers. They came and looked at the technology, and they, according to this inventor, they said that, you know, this is very exciting. We're going to take this and we're going to share this, and you know, this is the deal that you've been waiting for. He tried to follow up with them, and he wasn't able to even get in touch with these guys. And finally, he was able to. And the message that came back was that the companies are not ready for it yet. It doesn't fit within their existing paradigm. And to be honest, they were coming to investigate on whether they could save 1 or maybe 2% on efficiency. And the paradigm shift that he introduced, it doesn't fit into any of their corporate plans. So it's not that everybody within these corporate structures are mind controlled or bad people, but the system itself is geared in such a way for self-preservation, and now that's extended into attacking the essence of life and basic rights, defending itself at the expense of everything else around it. So energy technologies do exist. It's becoming more and more clear for those who are doing their research and checking out independent sources. And I feel, you know, within five or ten years, we're going to have a big shift, and people are going to realize the extent of the corruption on this planet, especially around the energy issue, and we're going to have a proliferation of solutions.
Wow, you're very optimistic, Josh. I like that. And
I'll say this, though, but what it will take at this point, not in 5 or 10 years, at this point what it will take is, if you're listening to this right now, decide that you want to play a role in this transition. Decide that you want to take a stand and you want to be involved in this solution. Because the watchdogs are all gone. They're all been kind of taken over by corporate interests, and it's up to the people. And we feel that we have with this movement, it's got its thumb on a very, very hot topic, which this activist movement is unique in the sense of it's the only one that I can think of, that I can see, that we are directly in a business relationship or contract with the organization that is causing the harm. So we have a direct ability to change that contract. We have a direct ability to influence our situation instead of trying to stop a big sort of monolithic thing that's kind of vague and that we can't directly, you know, do. But because we're buying electricity and water and gas, we can directly change the course of this, as many cities and many utilities have already done so. You know, there's been city councils who have watched Take Back Your Power, and they've chosen to not go ahead with this smart meter agenda after doing that and after hearing from enough of their local constituents that demand that they don't push it forward. There's been utilities who have chosen, and in the face of liability that will be involved if the people hold their feet to the fire, they've chosen not to install smart meters. And of course the city councils are being increasingly asked to step up their level of commitment as the people step it up. So it's a big opportunity.
Well, Josh, you're certainly putting the pressure on this issue and on the front lines of the activism as well. And I'm really thrilled to see this video and to meet you in Huntington. So that's going to be a lot of fun. I thank you very much for being on the show.
Absolutely. My pleasure.